Welcome to the show. I'm Carson Daly. Let me start with the music on the program tonight. And I think everybody in this room is very excited, as are we, making their network television debut. And may I add, it is long overdue.
An acclaimed rock and roll band who thought nothing of staying up all night to be here at this ungodly hour.
Began singing and playing their musical instruments together 10 years ago in Seattle. They have a big hit song.
Float On from their new CD.
Good news for people
who love bad news. Please welcome
Modest Mouse.
Modest Mouse.
Modest Mouse.
Modest Mouse.
My name is Andre Cannizzaro, and as you can see, I'm the focal point of this documentary. I didn't like that. That's all I want to say in the first opening shot. Or maybe I should say, Andre Cannizzaro. Or no, but my name is Andre Cannizzaro. Andre Cannizzaro. And as you can see, I'm the focal point of this documentary. This is about my life. The Road, Modest Mouse. Okay, cut there. Yeah, he was done a long time ago. Carver looks really nice. It's nice and clean, smells good, smells like cinnamon. Yeah, it's not too wet, but it's not too dry at the same time. Oh, oops. Oh, I got a spot there. Hold on, I'll clean it up. I'll clean it up, I promise. Yes. In 2 minutes. All right, thank. Yeah, we packed warm. Okay. All right, thank you. All right, ready to go.
I'll probably start by explaining how obsessed Dre and I are with the band Modest Mouse. We'd only been listening to them for a couple of years, but it had gotten to the point where they were all we listened to. We knew everything about them, and we knew all the lyrics, but we still didn't have a clear picture of what they were really like in person. They weren't on tour near Dallas, so we decided we would drive to Colorado. We didn't really have a plan. We got tickets for the show in Colorado Springs, but couldn't get any for Boulder. But that was enough. So we packed up our stuff and our cameras and got in the car and left for Colorado.
See ya, bye. Just this crazed, obsessed fan who obviously has problems. And it's weird because I've never been this obsessed about anything. And I don't like using the word obsessed because for a long time people would say, you know, you're obsessed with the band. And I would say, no, I'm passionate. I'm passionate about what I'm doing, what I'm liking. And for a long time, it's really funny because the first time I ever listened to Modest Mouse, I didn't like them. I thought it was long and boring, and it didn't sound good, you know? It wasn't regular music. And then all of a sudden, one day, I was listening to my car, and it just clicked with me. And I became a pretty good fan.
The Mouse started with modest beginnings. A small wooden shed built by Isaac Brock, a quirky teenager from the town of Issaquah, just outside of Seattle, Washington. It was the early 90s and the Seattle grunge scene was just taking off, but Isaac Brock was making a very different sound. Some of his earliest musical recordings include a collection of very unique and very brief songs recorded on answering machine tapes between 1994 and 1995. He used these tapes for a project he would call Dial a Song, in which people could call for a new song every day. The recordings included mousy vocals, distortion guitar, and a kazoo. He would later team up with local drummer Jeremiah Green, guitarist Dan Gallucci, and short-time bassist John Wickhart to create the earliest tracks released under the title Modest Mouse. They would practice in the small shed outside of Isaac's mother's trailer, and record at Dub Narcotic Studio under producer Calvin Johnson. Their first single, Blue Cadet 3 Do You Connect, cut in 1994, includes three Dub Narcotic recordings and two of Isaac's Dial a Song tracks.
Do you connect?
Eric Judy permanently assumed the position of bassist, and the band cut their debut LP in 1996 on Up Records. After that, the band made their mark on the indie rock scene, with a one-of-a-kind sound and an unmistakable lyrical style.
The good times are killing me. The good times are killing me. So long to all that LSD. So long to coke and methamphetamine.
Can't sing.
The good times are killing me. Just clenched tight, we talked all night about what the hell did we say. Good times are killing me.
Me and Roddy were arguing about this jacket, and actually, he says it's more of a shirt. I'm like, well, like I said, jacket. I consider it a jacket.
It's a shirt. So, do you want to get like a, like what, like a Motel 6 tonight?
Something like that. Maybe a little bit higher, classier. But classier.
In a row singing, please set us out just as fast as you possibly can.
Okay, when is there going to be like something? Come on.
Sucks.
You know, he was on that he was what made that, he's what created that, he was with Elvis creating that great new rock and roll sound, you know, Peggy Sue, like, she wore a jacket.
It's not a jacket.
Wore a jacket.
Why not?
Okay, babe. You know, this is what the documentary is all about, is showing Isaac Rock that he's got true fans out there. Real fans. People who will drop what they're doing, drive 14 hours, and spend a bunch of money just to go see him play for 2 hours. That's what it's about.
Sad song, last dance, and no one knows who the band was. And Henry, you dance like a wood Indian.
It's nice to look at, though. I like the scenery.
Yeah.
I mean, not much to talk about, but it's something to look at. It's you know, it's, what's that word I'm looking for, you know, calm,
Tranquil?
Kind of, but...
Why do you misplace the map?
Because I misplace things, that's what Dre does.
No,
I've only got the peak on here.
Never heard! No. That's what I know, that's the cap on. Here, you play with that. We missed this.
What?
Take exit number 42.
It's a long drive inside a car. 300 miles is a long drive inside a car. 400 miles is a long drive inside a car. 500 miles is a real long drive in a car. 600 miles is a long drive inside a car.
We left home in Dallas and drove for 13 hours through parts of Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, and Colorado to get to Colorado Springs. The trip was long, most of which was a 350-mile stretch of nothing through Kansas.
Man, we need to go through an exciting state next time.
So you think you figured out everything, but we know that our minds are just made out of string.
We had two tickets for the concert at 32 Blue in Colorado Springs, and planned to go to the show at the Fox Theater in Boulder 2 days later in hope of getting in somehow. We finally arrived in Colorado after dusk, unable to admire the beautiful scenery for lack of light. The silhouettes of distant mountains surrounded us and could only be seen by the sporadic gold lights which covered them. It looked like glitter across the night sky. We rolled into downtown Colorado Springs around 1 o'clock, the morning of November 15th, the day of the show. I found a Ramada Inn on the outskirts of Colorado Springs, and Dre haggled with the manager. We carried our suitcases and cameras to the room, poured some Sky Vodka into our bottled Cokes, and walked around downtown near 32 Blue. Then we went back to the motel, drank some more, and went to sleep. The band received growing acceptance as a unique and talented indie rock group. After their 97 release on Up Records, Dan Gallucci left the band, and Modest Mouse began playing shows with guitarist and keyboardist Robin Peringer. In 1999, they signed with Sony Music and released their third full-length LP on Epic in 2000. After returning from a brief side project, Isaac began the process of the band's fourth LP in 2002. But the band was having trouble. Around the time that Dan Gallucci returned, Jeremiah Green took a leave of absence. With temporary drummer Benjamin Weichel of the Helio Sequence, the band started over on the new LP, and began playing shows with their new lineup and new songs in 2003.
Behind 32 Blue in Colorado Springs on a beautiful day, waiting for the great band Modest Mouse to arrive.
We waited outside for over an hour, me holding a large over-the-shoulder camera and watching members of the opening act, Winford EI, unloading their equipment from an old beat-up van. Then we spotted Isaac Brock in the window of the club, eating alone. He had a hat on and a large coat, and no one was around him. We stood out there with our camera not really knowing what to do, and then we kind of waved at him. He didn't really acknowledge us, and so we didn't think he was going to come outside. Then he walked away. We walked around to the front as he came out the front door.
Yeah, we just met Isaac Brock 2 minutes ago. He was eating a sandwich, and I didn't even recognize him at first. I was like, who is that? And then I walked by, and he looked at me like, oh, that's Isaac Brock. Because he doesn't have the sideburns anymore. He had a cap on. And he came outside, and I started talking to him, and yeah, he's a pretty shy guy, and started asking about music because I'm an idiot, and he pretty much doesn't remember anything from anything I ever asked him about. So what about that song, guys? What song? That song? Oh, yeah, I remember that. God, I thought that was destroyed years ago. No, it's still on.
We asked him if he'd do an interview for us, and we told him about our documentary. He saw my camera and he said he liked to keep photos of himself as few and far between as possible. But he said maybe after the show he may say a few words to the camera when he was a little bit less sober.
He said he would talk to us after he had a couple of drinks, which is classic Isaac. Classic Isaac. We should have offered some drinks to him. I got a bottle of Sky in the car. Anyways. I just met Isaac Brock.
We went back to the motel and returned around 4 o'clock to be first in line. It was dark then and really cold, so we went in and out of the dining area of the club to stay warm. Eventually we saw Eric Judy, the bassist, standing at the bar trying to order some food. I approached him and introduced myself, and he was really nice, and he seemed really tired, and he said that he had just woken up and he just wanted to get his food and go back upstairs. Dre said hi to him also, and then we left him alone and went outside. As it got later, the line outside got really long. The doors finally opened and we made our way to the front with our cameras. There we met Rose, a college student from Fort Collins who hosted a radio show at her university station. Winford EI played a short set, and they were good, kind of a dark western sound. Then the Helio Sequence came out. We were thoroughly impressed with them.
We'll be right back.
hadn't met them earlier, but we couldn't wait to meet them that night. Then Modest Mouse came on. Isaac seemed angry at the beginning. He tried to tell a story, and a lot of people kept shouting at him.
Shut the fuck up!
Hey, good news, dickhead! You don't have a mic, I do! Shut the fuck up, quit bothering me, and let me do my thing, and everything goes better. Fine? Fine.
He was getting irritated.
I'll cut through the really quick. Shut the fuck up! No, me too.
However, they played an amazing show.
Okay, let's play a show.
Thank you.
not used to it. I gotta boil my spaghetti a little longer. I gotta drink a little less links. Wait, drinks. Yeah. Y'all have a good night. We're gonna have a really good time on the campus someday. That's it.
After the show, we stood on the street corner waiting for the band to come out. We saw Eric Judy again, and we said a few words to him, and he told us about the first time he met Isaac. And we asked him a few other questions, and he was really nice and talked to us for a while. Rose told us that she had driven, and she didn't really feel like driving back because she had a few beers, and she was really tired, and it was a couple hours to her house, so we invited her to stay in our motel room. She went to park her car in a garage to avoid being towed. And as Dre and I waited on the street corner, we met a local music student named Omar. Then Isaac came out. He was really drunk, and we decided not to ask him for an interview just then. The time didn't seem right, and he seemed a little bit angry, a little too drunk. So we talked to him for a while about movies, and then he started going through Omar's backpack for no reason, and pulled out a copy of the novel Of Mice and Men. We invited Omar to our motel room as well, and he followed us back in his dented Volvo. And then after a couple hours, Omar went home and Rose and Dre and I went to sleep. And the next morning, we took Rose to her car, then we packed up, checked out, and headed for Boulder. After driving around from place to place for hours, we finally settled on a Holiday Inn just north of Boulder. The next day, we woke around noon, we met up with my friend Shelly, who was attending CU at the time, and then we went to the venue.
Right now, we're in Boulder outside the Fox Theater, waiting for Modest Mouse. They should be pulling up anytime soon. It's really cold outside, so I hope they really show up soon. And there's a man walking, running.
The three of us waited in the alley for the band to arrive, and there we met Alex, another local college student. He was helping with the show. He didn't actually work for the Fox Theater, but I think a friend of his got him the gig so that he could see the show and meet the band.
Jim is the coolest guy ever. I like that guy a lot. That's my
no idea what you're talking about. No
talking
idea.
About
he's
Jim
a,
Palmer.
He's a film teacher, and he's like,
he's just badass.
You could interview him now, but he'd love it. But he takes film really seriously, so it's like nice to.
Yeah, and he really loves what he does too. Yeah, he has such a good time in class. It's awesome.
Yeah. It's cool.
Are you filming our conversation?
Perhaps.
The Modest Mouse equipment truck arrived, along with the Helios sequence, and we said hi to them. But again, missed Modest Mouse's arrival because they parked in front.
They must have come through the front. But it's cool, just keep shooting.
Brandon Summers, the singer and guitarist of the Helios sequence, talked with us for a while, and we complimented him on his set from Colorado Springs. He asked us if we had tickets, and we told him we didn't, so he offered to put us on his guest list. We were really surprised at that, and Shelly wrote down our names on a sheet of paper and gave it to him. We saw Isaac for the first time inside the club as he was coming out of the backstage area. He was looking for one of his friends, and he said he needed him to draw an idea that he had. Dre told Isaac that I could draw, and he told me what he wanted. He explained he needed a hot air balloon with an anchor instead of a basket.
Hot air balloon?
Drum, okay.
No basket.
Drum and a hot air balloon with an anchor.
No color.
I said I'd draw it for him, and then he wandered off. I made the drawing on a napkin, and we waited around inside the club. Eventually, the members of the band Winfred E.I. showed up. We asked them if we could tape their set that night, and they said of course. Then we walked around town for a while, wasting time, and eventually came back inside the club to hang out in the lobby. At this point in the day, I was feeling really antsy at the fact that I didn't really have any good footage of the band, you know, what we had come to get. And the plan was for Dre to ask permission from one of the band members, maybe Isaac or Eric, for an interview, and then I would shoot it and Dre would interview them. So I really needed him to go ahead and try and get something, and then I could just record it. It didn't really feel right, me holding the camera and asking people, because then I would have to get Dre to cooperate. Well, he didn't really seem to be putting forth much effort to get that. Like, we were starting to run out of time. So we hung out in the club area for a while, and then Isaac and Eric came out, and they crossed the street to a record store. Well, Dre followed, and Shelly and I sat there in the club. After about 10 minutes, I walked over there to find Dre and Isaac discussing music, and Eric browsing around. Well, as soon as I came in with my camera, Eric and Isaac left, and I got really mad at Dre for just standing around and talking to them rather than trying to get what we had come for. So we returned across the street to the club, and in the lobby we found most of the band members sitting around a table eating, while Dre, Shelly, and I sat over to the side. I was getting itchy trigger fingers with the camera, and the scene in front of me was so perfect. It was all the band members sitting there eating. And I had the camera on the table, so I just kind of subtly turned the camera on and pointed it towards them. And I didn't realize that Eric was watching me the whole time, but he was. And he leaned over and told Dan that I was filming them. And Dan looked over, and then Eric asked me if I was. And I dumbfoundedly replied, "Is that a problem?" Then everybody at the table nodded. I felt really stupid, and I had to leave the room. Before this trip, we were the biggest Modest Mouse fans, and they were so important to us. Mostly their music, but along with the fascination of music comes fascination with the musicians. And we had to meet them. And not only that, we had to make a good impression. So we drove to Colorado to meet the band, see what they were like, try and figure them out, and know that they thought we were cool guys, because that was really important. We really wanted them to make some kind of connection with us. And we wanted to bond with them in some way. We wanted to go home with a feeling of connection with the Modest Mouse band members. And in that sense, we failed. I felt really stupid, and I had to leave the room. After that, the band went backstage to get ready. We waited out front in the cold by the box office, and watched as our names got copied from the little receipt that Shelly gave to Brandon to the main list. I had the big camera again, and Dre had the little one. As the doors opened, I got stopped by a guard, and he told me no video. Well, I tried to explain that we had permission from the band members, but he still said he couldn't allow it. So I had to go to my car to put the camera in the trunk, as Dre snuck by with the smaller camera. When I came back from my car, I ran into Alex on the street and told him what had happened. He offered to let me in through the back door, but I told him, don't worry about it, I didn't want to get him in trouble. So I went inside, and I met up with Shelly and Dre in the front. Shelly wasn't feeling good at the time, she was coming down with a cold, and she actually left before the opening act. When Win for the Eye came on, Dre started to shoot with the smaller camera, and was stopped by a security guard. When the Helios sequence came on, we waved to Benjamin, and he came over, and we explained what had happened. He went backstage, and when he came back, he gave us a thumbs up. And then the same security guard came over and told us that we could now shoot. So I filmed the Helios set on that one camera, and we got a great show. And then Modest Mouse came out.
What a best game tonight. That's the joke. That's the material. These are the jokes. God damn.
Isaac was coming off as a stand-up comedian that night.
Good night, everybody. Good night.
He was really having a lot of fun and getting really drunk, and he did a great encore.
We'll be right back.
then after the show, we waited in the alley again. There were some fans out there. There was an English woman who really wanted to get a picture with Isaac. And then Isaac came out and got a picture with a girl.
I think I had a red eye on that one.
And then I started to apologize. And he gave me a little bit of a lecture. He told me that I had really bummed out some of his band members. And that he was really upset about it, but he would accept my apology and he would pass it on to the rest of the guys.
I mean, they...
And then finally he agreed to an interview, so we turned on the camera. But we were a little bit humbled at the time, so we didn't really ask him any questions, and he was busy with fans. Isaac said to me personally that the band members were angry with me, and I was on their shit list. I had personally upset people that I admired, I mean truly admired, and that was so significant. And that really brought the whole trip to a halt. A couple minutes later, Eric drove the van up. The whole band was in there, and Isaac stumbled over and got in, and then they drove off. So we stood in the alley for a couple of minutes, feeling really regretful, like we had screwed up our trip. Then the lead singer of Winfred E.I. stumbled out, pretty drunk, and he approached us and told us how sorry he was that we couldn't shoot his show. We could tell they had been talking about us backstage. We talked to him for a couple minutes about their upcoming shows, and we told him we'd probably see him again, and then he stumbled up the alley. And we went to my car and went back to the motel room, fell asleep. The next morning we woke up, checked out, and left Colorado.
Gets longer, awful, feels softer, and it feels pretty soft to me. And if it takes shit to make bliss, well, I feel pretty blissfully. If life's not beautiful without the pain, well, I just would rather never ever even see beauty again. Well, as life gets longer, awful, feels softer, and it feels pretty soft to me. Yeah. Yeah.
really blows my mind. I can't stand there. That's it.
We rolling?
Yeah.
We rolling the camera. Ooh. All right. The other night, I broke another pick because I play really hard for some reason. And I was like, shit. So what I did was, I remembered that I had a pick from the show that I grabbed. It was from Helio. I'm certain it's from Helio Sequence because it's orange. And so I've been playing with the Helio Sequence pick. And since then, it hasn't broken on me.
Where the hell did you get that from?
A stagehand gave it to me, because, you know, when everybody, at the end of the show, you know, people yell for everything, they're like, I want this, you know, I want the set list, I want this, I want that, and I was like, hey, I want the pick on the floor, like, so he grabbed me the pick, and I thought it was Isaac's, but learned later that was probably Helios Sequences, well, it is Helios Sequences, it's obvious it was theirs. So, ever since, I've been playing with Helios Sequences' guitar pick. Now, I would love to tell you that I've gotten better because of this pick, but I don't know. But, now, Isaac might know of Taylor Guitar, but this is a Taylor Guitar, handmade in 1976 for my dad, who lived in San Diego. Now, if you go to any guitar store, like Guitar Center, there's a big, like, banner that says Taylor Guitar on there. There is a very well-known company to people who are guitar connoisseurs. But this is a handmade Taylor guitar from 1976, still in pristine condition. My dad knows how to keep a guitar. And I've been playing it, and it's probably out of tune. But I don't really care, because I don't want to tune a guitar.
Custom concerns on the table, build a monument says people's to wear. Out of our eyes, I get up just about noon. My head sends a mess for
the first time we met Isaac Brock was outside of 32 Blue, the club in Colorado Springs where they were playing. And we were sitting outside waiting. We had thought the band hadn't arrived yet because we thought they were still driving their old van. Well, I saw this guy eating a sandwich in the window. So I went and passed him, you know, wanted to go inside. And right when I saw him, we locked eyes at the same exact time. And he gave me this weirdest, kind of a cold look. And I was like, oh my god, that's Isaac Brock. And I was like, oh Rich, that's Isaac Brock. And he was like, yeah, I think it is. And he got up and he was leaving, and Rich kind of started panicking. He's like, oh my god, we're never gonna have a chance to talk to him ever again. So Rich came and knocked on the door, on the window, and caused a fuss. And you know, Isaac just kind of looked and didn't do anything. And then we're like, oh great, you know, there's our chance, you know, our chance is gone. We'll never ever see Isaac Brock again. And we walked to the door, and we saw him walking to the door, and we're like, oh my god, he's coming outside. You know, we gotta say something. He comes out, first thing he says, what can I do for you, gentlemen? Hey, Isaac, blah, 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 said my last name. This is Andre Cannizzaro, nice to meet you. And then I said the stupidest thing ever. I was like, we just came out here to say that we find your music inspiring and that you have made my life a little bit better and that I wanted to thank you for it. And he's like,
we'll be right back.
got back from Colorado, Richard and I were watching the concert footage, and I suggested him that he take it and he make it into a little video. I figured since there was no good concert videos of Modest Mouse out there that people would be interested in ours. I figured, hey, let's make a couple extra bucks and fund our next trip to Florida. You know, once again, we're going to go see the band. Well, what started as a small venture soon became our lives. And every day, Richard worked on it until it was finished.
That's why we're trying to start this like new business thing.
We're not going anywhere. We're not marketing towards anybody. This Modest Mouse video is gonna last like...
Oh no, that's just a side project, but this is get us money to, you know, get a better computer.
We don't need better advertising. We don't need better equipment, dude. Nobody's gonna know the difference if we shoot our XL1 edit here. We are ready to go. We need customers, we need marketing.
Well,
right. Give me another beer. That's
good. Bring me one too, please.
You want a beer?
Yeah.
Please? I've already had three. We're gonna answer my dad if he notices.
It's a
car payment in a few days.
I'm on the car payment plan.
Made about $600 in the past couple of weeks.
Well, hey, dude, I need to go too, man. I've been doing nothing but thinking about the band 24/7.
Well, yeah, that's the thing that keeps me like, you know, on track.
Same here.
It's the fact that I've got something to look forward to. I think that should be the title of our film, Medication.
No, that's the title of a song.
Yeah.
No, I wanted to be the day we pissed off Modest Mouse.
That's not the point of the film. You never have like a track in your mind. It needs to be. We need to have a focus for this film.
Modest Mouse came as a rat. No.
Well, that's not the focus of our film.
Yes, it is, because we're going back to see him because.
But that's the focus of our film. I'm not even bothered. I'm not going to the Florida trip.
Why?
Because that's not what the film's about, Jack.
What's the film about? I'm just passionate about the band. That's all. There's nothing wrong about being passionate about
something. There's nothing wrong with it, but you need to be creative on your own.
I am creative.
Okay.
It makes me try to be a better artist.
Okay. There's a start.
After it was completed, I started marketing the video, and I got an official web address, fuelcann.com, and Richard designed the web pages. We even had a business meeting with his father, who was in video production, and he gave us some advice on how to sell it. Well, the day the website went up, I got about a couple of hits, and then the next day, I woke to find 200 more. And I was completely mind-boggled. For once, people were interested in what we were doing. And everything was going right. And then at that exact moment, Richard called me. And before I could give him the good news, he gave me the bad news. Early on a Thursday morning, Isaac Brock emailed us threatening to sue us. It was a huge blow to us. I mean, it just felt like we had lived in this false reality for so long, only for it to be shattered by the man we most admired.
Not in a million years I think this would happen.
What we gotta do is figure out a plan how to fix our relations with Isaac and ask him and tell him, hey, what can we do? You know, we have this great video of your concert. No, nothing else. No, I mean, any other footage we got of you, it's not in there. It's just the footage of the concert strictly. We just wanted to sell a couple of videos to the fans. And, you know, because there's no really good video of you guys, you know. And every, you know, fan I've showed this to loved it, you know. You know, my friends, I've only showed it to like 4 people. And they all thought it was great. And, you know, we have to really figure out how to work this out. Because I was never against getting permission, but I mean, you know, it's so hard to go about that because, you know, how do you contact them, you know? I don't want to be threatened, dude. Don't threaten me. It's no fun.
When I wrote the whole website thing, I knew it felt sleazy. It felt really scandalous. Because it's a marketing thing, so it's going to sound, like, very bad.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to advertise something and not sound like
like
a scumbag.
Right. Everybody would, like, love to see it, but if they don't want it out there, I mean, it's good songs. That's all it is. And I just wanted to get it out there.
Yeah.
I wanted to treat Modest Mouse fans to something that they haven't seen before.
Yeah.
You know? I have to get some ass, dude. I have to get some ass. That's just no problem.
Do you think you know most everything?
It's all
for you. You know that our hearts aren't just made out of strings.
Yeah, it's not very likely that we're going to get to work with them now.
Maybe not. Immediately, Rich took down the website and canceled the video. We both wrote apologies to him, and we were hoping he'd understand. It was so hard to look at the word Modest Mouse, let alone hear one of their songs. I remember I got in my car that day, and the first thing to play was Modest Mouse, and I just had to turn it off. The next day, I woke up getting Richard's phone call, and he just got an email back from Isaac thanking us for the removal of the website. He also told me that he replied to me as well, and so I was quick to read it. His email gave me hope again, and for an instant, everything seemed like it was going to be okay. Right now, I'm in Dallas, Texas. In about a matter of an hour, we're ready to get on our trip to Florida, about a 20-hour drive, just to see one band, which is very obsessive. But I'm not obsessed. We're going to first apologize when I meet Isaac. I'm going to first apologize about all our misunderstandings in the past, because it was my New Year's resolution to stop offending the band. But since I broke that in a matter of a few days, I decided to try and make amends with the band, and that's what this whole trip is about. The Colorado trip was going and being, you know, being liberated and just saying hi to a group of musicians that made my life a little bit better. And now this trip to Florida is trying to apologize for making an ass out of myself the last time. Well, I hope I have a good trip. Hope that nothing bad happens along the way. Of course, if it does, maybe we'll get it on camera. And everything will go oh so smooth. See the boat in the background?
Yeah, go.
We just drove like 12 hours, 10 hours. We're in Florida, right on the tip, behind this beautiful scenery, and we're about to get on the road again and get to someplace.
Tampa.
In Tampa, in Florida. Florida looks nothing like I thought it would. I was thinking like old people and retirement homes, like all up and down the road. And
Cubans running everywhere.
Yeah, Cubans running around with cigars in their mouth going, aha, bring back Ilion, aha.
It was lame.
Yeah, I don't know. That's so funny, everybody just forgot about Ilion Gonzalez. It's like a big thing, like all over the goddamn news for long periods of time. And then all of a sudden, like, he laughs and like, oh, well, fuck. Oh, well.
back to Communist Cuba for you.
Ooh, we bear all.
But you know what? Those pictures aren't really, like, flattering. They look like they're taken in the 80s. Things about Modest Mouse, dude. Things about Modest Mouse. You're so obsessed, Richard. You're so obsessed. You know, you buy everything on eBay. You call me all the time and tell me, hey, Dre. You know, hey, Dre, guess what I got? You know. Hey, Dre, I found this record signed by Isaac. I offered the guy $300. I'm thinking about starting an intervention with you because it's getting a little overboard. Every time I go inside your room, I feel like I'm being attacked by Modest Mouse. I don't know. Dude, I've noticed, like, every time, like, I'm driving to, like, out of state, there's always museums, like, for everybody, you know? Go see the John Jenkins Museum about his life, and you go there, and it... really just the man who, like, sold insurance. I don't get it. Not saying I didn't enjoy the museum, but, you know, you seen one briefcase, you've seen them all, really. I don't know. We left home in Dallas and drove 20 hours through parts of Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, and Alabama to get to Tampa, Florida.
Well, we finally made it to Tampa, Florida, see Modest Mouse. Our first agenda was getting a hotel room. Of course, our problem was that a lot of places were already reserved and booked, so we didn't have a lot of choices, so this is really the best we could do. So, I mean, you know, it's not much, but, you know, I guess it'll do. But what can you do on short notice? At 3 p.m., we arrived in Ybor City, a small town located next to Tampa, Florida, where the concert was being held. We drove past the venue, noticing that the band hadn't arrived, so we decided to try and find a place to stay for the night. Just our luck, we noticed a small inn right across the street from the venue. Well, we immediately started drinking and had about 4 screwdrivers, and then Rich and I fought over the shower. And of course, he won, so I went down to the street to see if the band had arrived yet. Well, as I turned the corner, I saw all the band members, except for Isaac, unloading their equipment from their truck. Well, I quickly turned the corner again because I wasn't ready to confront any of them yet. And then all of a sudden, I saw a man walking across the parking lot. I'm like, that's Isaac. And I was like, oh, I gotta do it now. I'm like, it's gotta be done right now. I was like, yeah, Isaac! Like a dork. And he kind of looks, he kind of starts walking. I'm like, oh, you know, just some moron. And then I kind of start walking up to him. And I was like, hey, it's Andre. He's like, oh, and he started walking towards me and shook my hand. I was like, hey, dude. I was like, hey, dude, I apologize about everything. He's like, oh, no, don't worry about it. He's like, after I got your reply, you know, I knew you guys weren't shady and everything you did, you weren't shady, and I would really like to talk to you about it. And he's like, after I saw the website, I knew that you guys had some skills, so I want to talk to you about it. I'm like, no problem, dude. And it was funny, because, like, I was, like, really just excited, and I was, like, kind of not thinking. I was like, yeah, I'm sorry, it was my New Year's resolution not to offend the band. And he's like, what? I'm like, I'm sorry, it was my New Year's resolution not to offend the band. He's like, oh, and he's like, you're kind of like, smile, and I was like, I really do deeply apologize. And kind of, he had to go. I mean, I understand. So he, I was like, yeah, dude, I understand you. You know, and he's like, yeah, we'll talk later about it. And I was like, yeah, it's cool, man. So,
sad about the thought that the band had forgiven us, Richard and I started drinking heavily, and with time to kill, we started walking around town drunk as skunks. We made our way to the club at around 8 o'clock, 2 hours before the show, and Dan Gallucci, the guitarist, came out. And at this time, we were really drunk, and I started apologizing to him, and we told him who we were. And he told us that he didn't really like what we did in Colorado. And I began to further apologize. And I started telling him how, you know, great of a guitarist he was. And then he just kind of looked at me and sort of just walked away. There was a few technical difficulties, so the concert didn't really start until about 10 o'clock. At which time, the Healy Sequence was already playing, one of our favorite bands. It was a small venue, so while all the opening acts were playing, you could see all the members of Modest Mouse just walking around.
I said hi to Isaac in passing, and then I saw Eric, and we both saw each other, and then we just kind of looked away. I had no idea what to say at the time. I just kind of felt like I had no right to ever talk to the man again. As I continued to walk around the club, Richard went over to chat with Trevor, the man who ran the merchant table. He said he recognized him from Colorado and wanted to go say hi. He told him he was the guy from Colorado and wanted to, you know, apologize, and Trevor just kind of told him that he didn't really want to talk about it. Modest Mouse went on stage and played a great concert, but it was interrupted by this huge headache I had once I sobered up. I was just so eager to talk to Isaac after the show and try to get things straightened out for good. When the concert ended, we went over to the merchant table and I wanted to buy the new 7-inch Float On record that had just been released. But Richard told me he didn't have any money, so I offered to buy him one, and I told Trevor I wanted 2 copies. Well, he told me he'd only sell me 1, and when I asked him why, he told us because, you know, we were scandalous. And at that time, I just realized that even though Isaac had said earlier that everything was okay, that it just wasn't. It just seemed like everybody in the band hated us. I was really naive about how easy I thought it would be to apologize to the band. Bummed out, Rich and I went back to the hotel room and poured us some drinks. And then we walked back to the club, and we sat on the curb and watched a steady stream of people leave. Well, this homeless man approached me and asked me for $1. And I gave him $1, and he asked me why I looked so gloom, and I started telling him my story. Well, afterwards, he just kind of looked at us and said, you know, you guys look like a couple of nice guys. Like, everything will work out. And I kind of believed him. And I thanked him for his time, and he thanked me for the $1. Then Isaac came out and asked us what we were still doing there. We said we were waiting for him, and we wanted to give him our DVD that we had made for him. And then he had this bag with this camera, and he took it out, and it was this really nice digital camera. And I thought it was funny because in Colorado, he looked at my camera and called it a devil box. And he said it was broken and asked if I could help him fix it. And I said, well, you know, maybe we could look at the manual. And he said he didn't have it, so he put it back in his case. So we talked for a little bit, and he kind of recapped Colorado and told us the same thing he did before about us really bumming his band members out. Before he left, he told us he wanted to take the DVD and make it into something greater. And then he left, and we went back to the hotel room and went to sleep.
The next night in Tampa, we arrived at the show, and the first thing I did was go to the merchandise table and try to apologize to Trevor again, because I felt really bad about it. And before I could finish, he apologized to me, and he said, you know, he was really sorry that he'd been kind of rude to me the night before, and he said that he wished that he felt the same way about a band. We shook hands, and I thanked him for saying that, and after that I felt a lot better. On the same night, Modest Mouse had their American television debut on NBC. The show was Last Call with Carson Daly, and they had recorded the performance a week prior in New York. Shortly before this, Modest Mouse had hit mainstream radio for the first time with their new single, Float On. This was something new to serious Modest Mouse fans. They were kind of like a well-kept secret for those who were lucky enough to hear their music. But this seemed to go against what they had made themselves into for nearly 10 years. We weren't really sure what to think.
We woke up around noon and drove 4 hours straight to Miami.
Just in the pile on that. All the years are nice, seem to touch my skin and the mistakes, who would blame anyone? I might have blamed more than everyone. The mistakes just in the pile on that. All the years now they touch my skin. Couldn't blame you but everyone.
Miami was not exactly as we pictured it. It was a dirty town with just too much traffic. We arrived at the Polish Social Club around 5 o'clock, and the band had already arrived. We sat on a curb, and Isaac Brock walked past us and said, hey guys, what are you doing here? And I was a little, like, puzzled at the time, because in Tampa I'd asked him if it was okay if we came to Miami, and he said it would be fine. We didn't really talk to anybody from the band, and we walked around the dirty town surrounding the club. But we arrived to find Christian and Zach, two people we had previously met that night, who were really big Modest Mouse fans. They'd driven all the way from Massachusetts just to see the band play. We talked till the doors opened, and then we went inside, and I made my way to the stage. Modest Mouse came out, and it was quite the sight when Isaac came out with a coffee filter over his head, and He started saying he was a pilgrim, and then he came over on a boat, and all this other stuff. Well, they were about to play when Isaac took out his camera from the previous night, and I thought that was odd. And he went to the mic and asked if the people from Denver, Colorado were there, and I was thinking, two guys from Denver, Colorado? Well, this guy made his way to the stage and said it was him, and Isaac said it wasn't, and told the crowd to push him back, and I yelled at Isaac, and he acknowledged me and told me to come get the camera. Well, instead, I pushed Rich to the stage, and he grabbed the camera, and it was really funny when people were trying to give Rich directions on how to use it.
Isaac handed me his camera, and he asked me to shoot some of the show for him. I was more than happy to do this, so I made my way through the crowd and found a good spot. Started shooting real close to the stage. After the first song, he stopped me and told me to go further back so I could get a shot of the whole stage. So I did that. I went all the way to the back, and a couple of fans helped me find a spot, and I stood up on a chair, and I was really excited. I hadn't eaten anything all day, so I was really shaky, and I pretty much shot the worst footage I've ever shot in my life. It probably looked really terrible, but I did it anyways, and I was so excited just to be holding Isaac's camera. A couple times, security guards had tried to stop me from shooting. They kept telling me no video, and I kept telling them it's Isaac Brock's camera. He's the lead singer of the band. He just handed it to me. So they let me shoot, and the entire show I walked around with Isaac's camera in my hand and got all kinds of different angles. After the show, I really wanted to talk to Isaac, you know, give him the camera back and thank him and ask him what he was going to do with it. He had mentioned that he was shooting for a documentary of his own. And unfortunately, I didn't see him inside of the venue after the show, but I did see Thomas. So I went up to him and I asked him if Isaac was coming out. And he took the camera from me and he said I could talk to him outside.
So we waited outside with Christian and Zach. Well, as time went on, Eric came out. And the whole trip, Rich and I wanted to apologize to Eric so bad, but there was never a right time. Well, as he got near, Rich approached him and started apologizing. Well, I followed and I started apologizing as well, and I told him how sorry we were. He told us that he felt bad for kind of giving us the cold shoulder the whole time, and we said it was okay because we probably deserved it. Well, Rich and I continued to wait for Isaac, and he finally came out, but he ran to his truck and left, and I was so taken back because I couldn't figure out if he was in a hurry or if he wanted to avoid us. As we drove home in the rain, I could only think of the growing popularity of Modest Mouse. In Colorado, Isaac told us that he and his band didn't want to be famous. And I believed him, but I knew in my mind that truly great artists can only avoid fame for so long. That night I apologized to Rich for blaming him for everything that had happened. We had a feeling in a short time that Modest Mouse fans wouldn't have the freedom to experience what we went through. The reality of it saddened us, but it was the perfect ending to our story.
Musical guest tonight, Modest Mouse on the show. Now we're talking. Modest Mouse. Wow. Not modest for long after a response like that.
my business too late and you wound up on. And I'm the shell with some bones that bars the left. And the one thing you told me about in the room of beings was this. That's all. Thank you very much for coming out. It was really nice to play the show. It was really, really nice to play the chicken chip as well. Thanks.
Give me a call. All right, you take care.